Welcome to NAIFA's Advisor Today podcast series, where we focus on how financial advisors work, live, and give to their local communities and our greater financial services industry. Now, let's get started with the show.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Advisor Today's podcast, where we focus on getting to know like-minded individuals like yourself and bringing the best of the best to you over our wonderful podcast. And it's been over a year now, Suzanne. So, you know, so are we 2 years?
2 years. Yeah, we're 2 years. Yeah, okay, 2 years.
So something that came out of nothing was we wanted to create the voice of you, the advisor. So with that being said, we have a great guest today. But Suzanne, before we get to our guest, can you share with us our sponsor, or who our sponsor is for today's podcast?
Sure, Chris, I'd be delighted to. So today's sponsor is no other than Advisor Today. We are celebrating our 4 Under 40 National Award winners. We're having a series. All of these people will be showing up to celebrate with us in person and get their awards at Apex, which is happening September 19th through the 21st at the Arizona Biltmore in Phoenix. And today's award winner that we're focusing in on is Peter Winovich III. So he is our special guest. And if you haven't registered for Apex, Chris and I will be there. He will be there. We'd love to see you. You can register at apex.nafa.org, and we're delighted to have you and get to know you today.
Wonderful. Welcome, Peter. How are you?
Hey, great. Happy Monday. Thank you so much for your time today.
All right. So, Suzanne, you mentioned that there's 40 under 40. Can you give NAIFA Nation a little bit background of what that is and how guys like Peter or individuals like Peter can qualify?
Sure. So Advisor Today is NAIFA's flagship media platform. It's inclusive of a magazine, a blog platform, our podcast here. We have webinar series, et cetera. We've got over 82,000 subscribers. So, you know, you've got a big audience out here. And the magazine has been in existence for 40 to 50 years. And in that time, they started creating the 4 Under 40 National Award winners to really highlight those people who are 40 years or under in age and are doing amazing things to move the industry forward. So each year we get nominations and applications come in, and a committee goes about doing the hard work of selecting just 4 people to win this national award. And then we showcase them. And we appreciate them. And of course, they have to be NAIFA members and doing kind of kicking on all cylinders, right? They got to be doing stuff in the industry, doing stuff in the community, being good citizens and the like. And so we're delighted that Peter is part of the class of 2024.
Nice. So, Peter, those are wonderful accolades. So Peter, do you happen to know why you got selected? I'm just curious.
That's a good question. I think it's because Lou Holtz's famous quote, it's not how much you know, it's how much you care. And I care for people. And I think that is emphasized by the clientele that I work with and the relationships that I built, for the last 16 years. So, it's been an exciting time, and thank you for the honor. And I'm excited to receive that award.
So, Peter, tell us a little bit about your practice, where you're from, and how you got into the business.
Yeah, it was 2007, and I was a senior at Bowling Green. I have a couple Bowling Green helmets in the background, and I was they had built this building in the end zone, and the corner like suite lounge area was the Wilcox boardroom, the Mike and Jan Wilcox boardroom. I thought that was really cool. Looked him up, saw he was a financial advisor, and reached. I asked my coach if I could get his contact information. I reached out to him, and about 40 interviews later, he said, "You know, we don't have a training program, but I want you to come on board, and we'll figure it out." You know, we don't normally take kids in right from college because we're so boutique, and it was a great experience. And that was going on 16 years, 17 years actually in September. So that's where I've been. So.
So tell us a little bit about your practice, Peter.
Yeah. So I would like to say it's a national practice. I work with a lot of sports figures, as you see with the helmets in the background, et cetera, and, but also business owners. So I feel I have a good geographic footprint across the country that I could go anywhere and just work with people that need help and really focus on holistic planning from the top down. I just had a call this morning from somebody looking for help on an estate plan. We talked through that, going to connect them with an attorney to walk them through that, work on the titling, et cetera. And that's, we also do a lot of asset management and really just try to be hands-on with the client.
So you mentioned the fact you went to Bowling Green, right?
Bowling Green State University, yes.
Okay, so share with us, how did you get into this space of, I see a Michigan helmet up there too. I see that. I see Indiana basketball up there.
My little brother played at Michigan for a number of years as a defensive end. So that was one of his helmets. And so football's run in the family for a number of years.
Got it. So you mentioned sports figures. Yes. You know, that's a space I know other NAIFA members wish or would consider. How did you get into working with sports figures or in the entertainment sport? I call sports the entertainment space because at the end of the day, that's what they're doing, entertaining people full time.
Yeah.
Share with us how you got into the space and then what are you doing to stay relevant in the space? Because this is a super competitive space.
Super competitive. And it started with my CEO working with a couple of different coaches, very high profile coaches. And that led to more coaches and then now university presidents, athletic directors, and conference commissioners all across the country. And I work with a lot of them across the board from there. So
share with us. So where is physically, where is your practice now?
We are in Toledo, Ohio.
Toledo, Ohio. Okay. Yep. That is right down the street, not too far away. So you're in Toledo, Ohio. You're doing a deal day to day. And are you still connected to sports at Bowling Green?
Yes, very much so, especially with the football team and through, you know, annual golf outings and going down to practices and just having a close relationship with the coaches, et cetera.
So did you play sports growing up? I mean, this emphasis on sports, I see tons of sports. Did you play sports? I heard you say your brother played.
Yes, I played at Bowling Green. Yep, played football at Bowling Green.
Was there a position that you were good at, or did they move you around, or tell us a little bit about your career.
I came in as a quarterback actually, and then I decided that, you know, I was wearing a blue jersey and I was fed up being like fifth or sixth string as a freshman. So I ran down and knocked out one of our star receivers on a kickoff return going through to tackle. So everybody on the team was, all the coaches were like, oh, we want him on defense. We want him on offense. So I, that was after I ran the hill twice because I was too aggressive on a play, but that I got noticed. And then I played my first game as at tight end at Oklahoma. So Adrian Peterson and I were same age and he had two touchdowns that game. And I was on the offensive side for BG. We had a good game against them. Didn't win though.
Fun.
So that was so 2 year starter there and had a great, great career, played every one of my games there. And then met my lovely wife there. And my sister ended up joining us at Bowling Green and she met her husband there. So between the both of us, there's six other human beings that were brought into this world because of my decision to go to Bowling Green. Pretty crazy to think that.
Yeah. And you had the courage to go out and get that spot, right? Go out and say, well, I got to do something about it. Yeah,
absolutely.
So what did you, so Peter, let's rewind the tape. What did you learn during sports that you feel, what trade did you learn in sports that you feel helps you in your day-to-day or in this business do pretty well?
Yes. I would say leadership and being accountable for yourself. So take care of yourself first. And then I would also say teamwork, right? making sure that you communicate effectively to the people around you. I just always remember the 5 a.m. drills and how frustrated we would get when somebody would do the wrong move while we were doing up downs. And that's important, being held accountable to yourself. And that's the type of standard that I try to live here in my professional career.
Interesting. You talk about up downs. You got to remember, Peter, most people don't know what that is. I mean, you got to remember you're throwing around athletic terms. The hill. Can you talk about what those things are? Because the average person doesn't know. I know what they are, but the average person doesn't know what those things are or why you have to do those things and what consists of those things.
Yeah, it's just up. You just the coach will blow a whistle. You get down. You got to get back up. You get down. And it's just mental toughness. And the type of drills that we would do at 5 a.m. would be to tire you out. But then you'd have to do a mental skill where you'd have to think about something. So that because in the game, you're going to be tired and you got to push through it. And same thing with being in a financial advisor is that you got to pick up the phone and call that person that might have said no 2 or 3 times. They said no because it was inconvenient for them at the time. They might say yes that next time. It's that, you know, picking up the phone and calling when you think somebody has a question on their portfolio. Did you have a gut feeling, et cetera. So it's doing those types of things and being consistent that really make you successful.
So Peter, I have a question. Go ahead, Suzanne.
I was just saying, it's that next play mentality. You're not holding on to what just happened. You got to move on to the next play, right? Next play.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So Peter, I have a question. You know, you never had the, you know, every kid out there has the dream of potentially playing in, you know, if it's football and NFL, if it's basketball, the NBA, if it's soccer, Major League Soccer. Share with us a little bit. Did you try and chase that dream? And if you didn't, or you did, either way, why not?
Yeah. By the time I was done, I was ready for a new adventure. I needed a fresh start and I wanted to use my head for its brain, not for smashing into other human beings. So that's what I decided to do. And, you know, whereas my brother, he played 5 years in the NFL, got drafted by the New England Patriots. So now he's on that same journey as I was when I was done. So it was, where I was at.
So like me, you're a recovering athlete. I understand.
Yeah. And I think also like in our space, financial space, is that it's competitive, extremely competitive. And that's like sports, right? So competition makes you better. And that's where, you know, why I really love this career.
So let's fast forward the tape a little bit. So share with us, 5 years from now, we're having this conversation about your career and you look back. Share with us a little, some of the things that you would like to accomplish over the next 4 or 5 years with your career.
Great. That's a great question. I think, just some things going on now are very transformational. So with my professional career, so I would say, you know, being in a spot that I feel extremely empowered to be able to impact the lives of the people that I want to work with and do it in a way that provides for my family, and I can do it with great mental health and clarity. So I would say 5 years from now, that's, you know, definitely one thing that I hope I could look back on and say, you know, I was able to accomplish that. I'd say the second is just being clear and concise with the things that I want to do and the people that I want to work with and being selective with that, because I have the fortune to work with so many wonderful people, but you know, you can't help everybody either. So just being more selective with the clientele that I work with.
you know, Peter, as a former football player, you know, I have a lot of friends and associates that played either Canadian football or played in the league, played in college. My son played in college. He was a cornerback Northern Illinois, which played Bowling Green for a while, but a couple of times. But here's a question. Do you have, and the guys, I'm a part of, we support the NFL Players Association here in Chicago pretty closely. And we know a couple of the presidents. As a person, do you have concerns about like your health going forward, that things you maybe don't know about that can, that that are out there that you're like, huh, I wonder if those things are going to apply for me? Is that something that concerns you, and how does it play into the planning that you have for you and your family? Because obviously it's important.
I think a lot of us are fearful of what happens when we're after out of the 440 demographic. And you know, I think there was just a report that just came out about, like, you don't age linearly, you age in
I saw that, like, there's two bursts,
44 and 60 or something. Pretty wild. No, I just, you just don't know. With all, you know, I look at the helmets that my brother had and versus the helmets that I had, it was vastly different. And I've had several nose surgeries just because that's how I played. So, yeah. But fortunately, I was able to get through college with relatively minor injuries, unlike some of my teammates. So, you know, knock on wood, that keeps going. But it's certainly scary. And I don't, and I think also, like, looking at future generations, like my kids, like, I want them to be active and play sports, but I don't know if I necessarily want them to play football at this age. Certainly I didn't end up playing until seventh grade. Mm-hmm. And then once I did, I loved it. I was addicted. Mm-hmm. So,
you know, Peter, that's interesting because, I'm on the concussion, the National Concussion Coalition, and they, you know, dealing with CTE and Chris Nowinski and all those guys. And one of the things that's relevant is the fact that if you ask all those guys that play, hey, would you let your kid play? And 98% of them say not until they're in high school. And that's interesting. That's interesting. That's interesting because when Peter was coming up, he was a little Pop Warner, right? He's getting there. Run around, even though you don't know what you're doing, just run around and hit each other. And that's how it works, right? And, you know, you get, you know, you remember Peter, they used to say the cobwebs. Hey, you get the cobwebs, hey, get up and you shake it off, right? And so the world has evolved, it's changed. Kudos for you for getting out when you did, you know, obviously, and giving yourself an opportunity to live a healthy life going forward. So what advice would you give for athletes specifically that don't make it? You know, I love that NCAA commercial. Everybody's going pro. I used to love that commercial. Yep. They don't play anymore. They need to bring it back.
They need to bring it back. Yeah, it's a great commercial.
If you were giving advice to someone who was trying to transition, whether they played in the big leagues or not, they transition from sports into this business, mm-hmm. what advice would you give them?
Well, first, thinking that most athletes that play collegiately and professionally often started when they're younger. So you identify as an athlete. So Peter Winovich, athlete or student athlete. When you're done, it's really hard to transition to the professional career, your professional career. So I think look to find mentors that in the athletic space that could help you transition. And it's no secret that if you hire an athlete or a former athlete, they often are competitive and they want to win. And when somebody wants to win, they take the time and the effort to prepare. And when you prepare, you have a greater chance of success. And that's so I would say seek mentors and also realize that you're not an athlete. You'll always be an athlete, but now you have to rebrand or put a new cap on moving forward.
The idea of using your head for something other than a battering ram, idea of using your body for something other than entertainment, so to speak, from an athletic perspective is always good. You know, let me ask you this, Peter, what was one of the hardest things you had to do when you started in the business? So many people start in the business and they say, oh, I'm gonna go out and make $1 million. I get it, right? But we all struggle, whether it's our year one, year two, year three, we all struggle with things. What were the largest struggles that you had in the business and you overcame them to have some of the success you're having?
Yeah, that's, I would say first is just finding somebody to trust you when you're younger, that just to take a chance on you. One of my first clients, it was like a snowy December, and I went down, had this beautiful plan crafted, and it was right at the end of the year, and I needed it to make it to New Year's, essentially. So they needed the plan as much as I needed the plan, essentially. And I remember that little bit of stress ultimately created hundreds of thousands of dollars for that individual through the plan that we put in place. And had I not fought through that stress, that wouldn't have generated that. And that was my first experience from there. So trying to, you know, stress, too much stress can be bad, but just enough stress can be good. And that's how I try to work through that.
Managing stress. Suzanne, let me throw this to Suzanne for a moment. Suzanne, how do you manage stress? Because again, you're running a high octane team too. part of NAIFA, and it's like a sports team. Like, how do you manage stress? And then Peter, I'm going to go back to you. Is how do you manage stress successfully? So we'll go with Suzanne first. Suzanne.
Well, I tell you, I learn a lot from all the I surround myself with athletic people like the two of you. I'm in a house of athletes myself. And so I also have to come back and say, wait, I'm an athlete too. So athletes, to your point, I make a lot of lists. I do a lot of positive affirmations, right? And you got to stay disciplined. It's consistency. So I just try to be as consistent and tenacious as possible, because then I say, you know, I control the controllables. And then I don't worry about it. If I've done, you know, it's kind of like putting it all in the field. Like I was just saying, I just became an empty nester. Some people, you know, a lot of mothers are out there crying. I'm like victorious because I left it all in the field with those two kids. Like I've done everything I can. I know that they're ready to go out there, and you can't worry about it, right? The outcome will take care of it. So that's what I try to focus on and control the controllables. Yeah. But I think, and then surround myself with good people. Yeah.
I think people look at stress, they look at it as bad. So we're saying stress can be good.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Stress is the motivator, right? You don't want to get complacent. That's death. Yep. Right?
Absolutely.
You know?
Okay. So kick it over to you, Peter. Peter, so how do you deal with stress on a day-to-day basis?
I would say anytime that stress gets too much, I try to do a change in temperature. And what I mean by that is like do a cold plunge or do a sauna or go in the hot tub or go in the shower. Anytime like you have a change in temperature, I find that helps with stress. And you know, I like to read a lot of stoicism as well. So
me too.
Yeah. That too. So that's but I would say probably my greatest weakness is stress / overthinking at times. So that is something that I'm always constantly trying to work on, but doing hard things really pay off. And it, when you look back on it, those periods of stress was ultimately a period of growth.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things I always see in a lot of our super successful advisors who have been athletes and versus those who aren't is that, you know, at game time, it's game time. Like you can't still be worried about work. You can't, you know, if you either put in the work and you're ready for game time, at game time, you got to play. And the advisors who come through that mindset do well, because the people that don't, they're still worrying about what they're doing while there's performance is performance, right, gentlemen? Yep. Like, that's it. You can't, you either put in the work or you didn't, but that's not the time to practice.
Yep.
Right.
Exactly.
But you know, that just comes back to the ideal that preparation, you know, you've mentally prepared. And the reason why you're mentally prepared is because physically you've prepared so much that you don't have to think about it. Yeah. Right. So muscle right. memory and yeah. understanding. And Peter knows this. Peter, what does it mean for you to trust the process? Of course, your coach always said that. Trust the process. Yeah. Yeah. Trust the process. You got to trust the process. Just trust your instinct. Trust the process. Peter, for you, what does that mean?
Yeah. So one is first identifying what that process is. So you have the confidence to trust it, right? And saying, hey, there's going to be periods of time that you're going to have doubt, and you got to trust what you're doing. Is going to get to the end zone. Not to bring up a football term, but that's so when I hear trust the process, it's you know, goals are great, but it's all the little things in between that make it to the to that goal. So that's part of that process.
So are you still like a miracle morning guy? Like, do you still have your time management completely structured out and to stay successful? Because football is so highly structured.
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say it's not as structured as some like time blockers that I know, like they put like when they're going to have coffee and stuff. But I'm pretty consistent with, I don't even need an alarm clock, and I wake up at the same time every day from there. So it's, and the more organized you can be in this profession, especially, is really important. I got a lot of papers on my desk because we've got a lot going on right now. You know, that's the trust the process. You know, Chris, where did you hear, asking you a question, you know, where did you get the trust the process? I know my coach at Bowling Green, a guy named Matt Campbell, talks about that. He's the Iowa State head football coach. He says, trust the process. So where's your experience on that? Asking you a question.
So my experience on trust the process is our coach used to say, you know, I played at the University of Illinois. And our coach used to say is that, you know, the best thing about being a freshman is one day you'll be a sophomore.
Yeah.
The best thing about being a sophomore is one day you'll be an upperclassman. And so he used to tell us, even if you're as skilled as the seniors just get it. And we never really understood that, right? Yeah. There was the unmeasurable, the things that you can't measure with how many rebounds did you get or how many blocks did you get. You can't, you know, the immeasurables. And so those things, he's like, you have to trust the process in which we're going to put you through, so that when you get there, you're prepared. We thought we were prepared because we're like, you know what? We just, you know, I scored on that guy more in practice and blah, 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 blah. And there's more to it than that. There's more to it. There's the professionalism there. There's the ability to be a good teammate. Yeah. There's the ability to be, you know, your ability to work hard in the weight room and be an example, your ability to work hard in practice, you know, all those things that go in, you know, a good student, you know, all those things that go into those things. And if you're not a good student, you attend study hall and you show up to classes, you're not a distraction. You know, all the things that go into being an athlete, that, again, the fan only sees
the score. This much. Yeah.
Right. And so I heard something when I was drafted. So I was actually picked up as a free agent in Chicago with the Bulls. And one of the things that they were big on was the psychology of the game. And part of that was you don't know what you don't know. And even when you know it, there's still more for you to know. And so we would look at plays and understand how they were ran. And then there was the alternative to that play, just like you guys were calling audibles and things like that. There was alternative to those plays. But when you got to the league, those alternatives, like in college, became multiple alternatives versus just one or two, right? And so you learned that, okay, got it. You know, you got to trust the way in which they're going to teach it to you, because they taught it all to you one time, be like drinking out of a fire hose. So, so we got back to the basics, and that's what I mean by this is, I think it's kind of cool for you as an athlete to come into this business and to excel, because you've got some of the tools that were innate in you and was built inside of you and then honed. Those skills were honed as mm-hmm. a young professional before you even got here, right? And so if you could teach those to others or share some of those experiences, people can live vicariously through your experience. I have a question for you, Peter. Coaches. Let's talk coaches. All right. So you played high school, college. Who is your favorite coach to play for and why?
Ooh.
A guy you just run through walls. You're like, you know what? That's my guy.
Love him and hate him at the same time. But Hall of Fame high school coach, Bill Chirpak, my high school coach. I think he's the fourth winningest coach in Pennsylvania history. Still going. So he made me a better person and player. Then I would say Coach Campbell. And I would also say, Coach Jadrawa. He coached at Ohio State for a little bit. He's a great guy as well. But so many other coaches during that time. Coaches make such a big impact on you just from a mental standpoint. And the best coaches that had that blend of being supportive, but also critical. And the ones that were overly critical caused a negative experience. So,
right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. Did you know any of those coaches that I mentioned?
No, but I'm going to go old school and new school, right? So how do you feel about, Suzanne, we got to ask him just like we asked somebody else who was on there. So Peter, how do you feel about the NIL deals and what they've done to college football?
Oh yeah. It's wild. It's created a huge opportunity for 18 to 22 year olds. And there's an entire ecosystem of new professions mm-hmm. now. For NIL, I mean, that's probably what's kept the job loss market figures down here. I'm just kidding. But it's probably overdone though right now, in the sense that the pendulum always swings one way or the other too far. And I think, it was like, hey, let's throw it out there and see what happens. And then the pendulum comes back here from there. So that, it's very interesting, though.
The one thing I would say is that it's changed the dynamic of sports altogether, right? Because each year, unlike when you and I were going through, Peter, what year did you graduate from? You finished Bowling Green?
2008.
Okay, so I finished in 99.
Okay.
Finished playing, right? And the dynamic of sports has changed so much since then.
Yeah.
The landscape of sports have changed so much since then. But I would say that there's so much opportunity now for people that are coming out to get into businesses like ours. And that mm-hmm. This is an opportunity that you can use some of the skills that you've been taught and learned along the way, some of the coaching, skill sets and coaching mental toughness, I'm gonna call it that, that some of the coaches implore on you. And you can utilize that to create just as much money as they do playing.
Yeah.
Right. And that's what I loved about this industry, is it gives us the opportunity to compete on a different field.
Yeah,
on a different court. So it gives us that space. So your inspiration, where does your inspiration come from in your work ethic?
I would say first and foremost, my family, making sure that I could provide for them is by far the number one thing. And doing that every day is what I want to do from there. So that's number one. And just trying to create a legacy from the actions that I take moving forward.
So I have to ask the question, Peter, you say you need a clock. What time do you wake up in the morning?
Somewhere between 5:30 and 6 usually. So it's pretty consistent around like 5:30 or 5:35-ish, I'd say. It's weird how like your circadian rhythm can match that. And if I sleep in, it's exactly 7 o'clock. So it's weird. So like literally 7 o'clock every time. So
Suzanne, the breakfast of champions.
Yeah,
that's right. I know. Miracle morning, man.
Breakfast of champions. Get up. They get up early, they get up often, they get it done before most people even start thinking about the day. So Peter, thanks for all those wonderful nuggets that you were sharing with us.
Yeah, hopefully it was enjoyable for you both and for the listeners. And I apologize if I sound a little stuffy. My entire family has been sick for like the last 4 or 5 days with some type of flu or something. So it's been, anytime you got little kids and they get sick and they cough,
petri dishes, all of them.
Yeah, those early mornings are really early because you're up all night.
They love to share all their little germs with you.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
So, Suzanne, let's take him to the speed round. You know, Peter.
All right, let's do it.
Listen, this is like
speed round. All right, let's go.
Yeah, here we go.
This is like ESPN game day here.
You know, yeah. Suzanne, he's competitive. He's up for it. Yep.
So we're going to take you to the speed round, and the goal of the speed round is just to kind of get to know you. People may actually see you. They may be like, that's that football guy. I saw him on the podcast. Got it. But they need to get to know you before people are usually approaching. You know, people want to talk to people that they feel like they know a little bit. So we're going to ask you some questions. Again, it's not crazy thought. Just whatever comes to mind first, that's kind of how you answer.
Okay.
So we'll go with your favorite food, Peter.
I would say Cicanti's pasta from Jefferson Hills, Pennsylvania.
Suzanne, you hear how specific that is? Like, he's got
Again,
he's
like, no, this is Chris, this. Like road trip.
Yeah, it's a little restaurant down at the bottom of the hill where I grew up. And I always say that if I was on death row, that would be my last supper. And I actually heard that the owner has not been doing well. So I just, just picked up the phone and called us out and told him that, and he got an absolute chuckle out of it. So,
that's cool. So, let me ask you. So that was easy. Are you an only child?
No, I'm the oldest of four.
You're the oldest of four. So as the oldest of four, what is it that you want all your siblings to see in you and replicate in you?
Wow. That's a deep. Well, being the oldest, just naturally from a leadership standpoint, I just hope that they see belief and they can believe in the things that I do, but also encourages them to do things that they need to do moving forward. So I just want to be a positive and encouraging role model for all three of my siblings.
If you were giving young advisors advice and you were able to stand up and they say you only get one word, what would that one word of inspiration be?
Passion.
I like it. Couple last questions. Do you have a favorite quote or a favorite book?
Ooh.
Or a movie.
So many quotes, but by far my favorite book is actually Jurassic Park. And everybody laughs at me when I say that. But I was 7 years old and I went to the movie theaters with my parents and I watched Jurassic Park and I was scared ridiculously. And I jumped in my parents' lap during that velociraptor scene. But I loved dinosaurs. And I found out about a week later that there was a book. And at 7 years old, I forced myself to read it, that novel, because I was so interested in it. And that, by reading that, gave me a lifelong love for reading that book, Jurassic Park. Hopefully that answers it. This isn't a speed round. I'm talking too much.
That's pretty good. That's good.
That's interesting. Yeah. Force yourself into doing that. That's good. Yeah.
Last question. You ready?
Yes.
So, I'll ask you a football question here in a minute.
Uh-oh.
What was your favorite part about football?
Favorite part about football? Wow. That's, I guess I would say the excitement when you're in the locker room and you put on your pads and you hear the crowd outside and all the whole week leading up to that, and all that preparation, you get to actually go out and play. And that was always just so exciting to me. That initial moment and that first snap, in the game.
Suzanne, I used to call that the cold chill.
Yeah,
like, that's right cool. Before you go out, the hair on the back of your neck stands up, you smell the popcorn, you listen, look over, and you see, hey, look, you come out and they're like, you know, it's just deafening noise. And all it is just silence noise. And you're just like, this is it. Like, let's go to work. So last question for you, Peter, we'll see you in Arizona. But if you can go back in history and have dinner or have a meeting with anybody in history, whether they're alive or they've passed away, they could be famous, not famous, whatever, or it could be somebody in your life, who would you go back and have dinner with and why?
I would go back to, and, I'd probably go back and see my Gigi, who passed away 24 years ago. I think, actually, what's today? I think actually today, interestingly. Tomorrow. So crazy coincidence, but just to ask her, you know, just so that she could see all the things that I was able to do, and also see, and she had a love for science like I did, and so that's just to see my grandma.
Awesome. All right, Suzanne. Before Suzanne goes, Peter, is there anything that you want to say to NAIFA Nation? Now you got all the ears of NAIFA, not just the new advisors, but now you have all the ears. Is there any words of wisdom you would like to share with our advisor today's audience?
I think the number one thing is, with our business, we have the opportunity to impact the lives of others. And it's a really special profession. And when I initially got introduced to it, I didn't realize the full impact that you have by going out and meeting with people and getting them to do things that are not easy for people to do, like buy life insurance or put together an estate plan or get them to set aside money for college education. But that's so incredibly important, and creating those positive impacts. You are special, and it's a very rewarding career.
Yeah.
Awesome. Peter, we look forward to seeing you in Arizona. Suzanne. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, Peter, do you know Patrick Scott? Because he's one of the other 440 winners. And I didn't even realize that he's another football player. Played collegiately.
Oh, really? Oh, it's a football. Yeah, so, football time. Yeah,
exactly. Didn't even try. Two of the four of our class of 2024 You guys can all talk all day long. Yeah. He started Stanford and then he went to Florida A&M. And so anyway, you guys can chit chat when we get there in Arizona. But yeah, Chris, we're excited to see everybody in Arizona. A couple weeks now, we'll all be there and being able to award our 440s.
Perfect.
Awesome. Thank you, man. Thanks, Peter, for being here. And thanks all of you for listening to Advisor Today podcast, where we focus on the voice of you, the advisor, and we come together collectively to make the industry a better place for those who we care about and those people that we serve, our clients. So thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next week. We'll see you at Apex.
Yeah.
At Apex.
Thank you.
So thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks for joining us for NAIFA's Advisor Today podcast series. Make sure to subscribe to get future episodes. And if you're interested in coming on the show, let us know.